The next item of business is a statement by Angela Constance on actions being taken to reduce drug deaths in Scotland. The Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Angela Constance, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The loss of life in Scotland from drug-related deaths is as heartbreaking as it is unacceptable. It's our national shame, and I offer my condolences to all those who have lost a loved one and my continuing commitment to do everything possible in our new national mission to turn the tide on rising drug-related deaths. On Friday, I attended a vigil in Glasgow. I talked to and heard from many people who have been directly affected by drug deaths, the very people who have been let down. Now more than ever, we need to make sure the experience of those living with problematic drug use are at the very heart of solutions going forward. That's why we're investing in local experience panels and a national collaborative of those with lived and living experience. We know drug deaths are preventable and avoidable. The publication of the 2020 drug death report on Friday was another stark reminder that the poorest communities suffer the most. That is why our national mission to save lives is linked to other work across this government to improve lives and mental health, to address poverty and inequality, to prevent adverse childhood experiences, to build resilience through education and prevention, and to bring a public health approach to our justice system. The 2020 annual report for the first time was the terrible scale of inequality between our most and least deprived communities. The power of this analysis underlines the need for better information about the problems people face, and we are making progress on this. Public Health Scotland is using a groundbreaking programme of data linkage, which will help identify where actions are most needed. The report shows wide geographic variation in drug deaths. Areas such as Glasgow, Dundee and Inverclyde are the worst affected. However, even the least affected areas in Scotland still have a greater problem in comparison to anywhere else in England. What we do know is that people in services have better protection from drug deaths, and we are focused on getting more people into protective treatment on the back of our long-term commitment to additional investment of £250 million, including £100 million for residential rehabilitation. In May, I announced £18 million would be allocated through dedicated funds for providers, including third sector and grassroots organisations, to improve services, to increase capacity and to improve access to residential rehabilitation and to support children and families impacted by problematic drug use. These are five-year funds and organisations can apply for multi-year grants. Since March, we have provided £3.5 million in new funding for around 80 projects. And this new approach is already helping to make grassroots and third sector organisations more sustainable. We published the medication-assisted treatment standards at the end of May. These standards set out for the first time what people should expect and demand of services, in particular same-day treatment and access to a wider range of options, including residential rehabilitation. I have given services a target this year to have the standards implemented by April 2022, although I expect many areas to have the first standard, including same-day prescribing, in place before then. I am meeting with Health Board Chief Executives on the 18th of August to drive home the importance of the standards as a national priority in response to Scotland's other public health emergency. To support implementation, we have provided an uplift in funding to alcohol and drug partnerships, and we have provided £4 million over and above for the specific improvements to meet the standards this year. The 2020 statistics show another rise in benzodiazepine-related cases. The Drugs Death Task Force and the Scottish Government have consulted on changes to prescribing practice and guidance. An expert group meets next month to build consensus on this, and the role of prescribers, including GPs, will be crucial in helping stop this number rising further in future. We also need to know more about who is using illicit benzodiazepines or street Valium, where they are using this and how they are using this, which is why I'm commissioning a rapid evidence review on the use of benzos so that we can take all necessary action to address this. And I will continue to push the UK government on allowing drug checking testing in Scotland and on the regulation on the possession of pill presses as well. The 2020 report also shows that methadone was implicated in more cases than before. I'm also commissioning urgent research on the role and risks of methadone in drug-related deaths, albeit in the context of polydrug use. We need to understand more about the drivers behind this trend, including prescribing practice and the risks and needs of the most vulnerable. I also want to see alternatives to methadone and long-acting buprenorphine made more available to people too. Presiding Officer, we know that the release from custody can be a vulnerable time for many individuals with increased risk of drug-related harms and deaths. The government will continue as a priority to mitigate any risks and consider ways to improve the circumstances and support available for individuals leaving custody. And we will commit to review the conditions around release from custody, including the issue of Friday liberations, as well as the wider issues of through-care support, release from remand and access to services. And we will work with stakeholders to consider the options available to us, including new models of care, as well as procedural or legislative change that may be necessary. Whilst men are more likely to use and experience harms from drugs, there has been a recent disproportionate increase in drug deaths amongst women. We know that there is a strong link between women having children removed from their care and the risk of drug-related death. And I have committed to get more women into treatment and recovery to tackle this issue around barriers to women accessing services and keeping families together. One of the priorities will be to develop and upskill women-specific services, in particular for residential rehab, where there are currently only limited options available. I am therefore pleased to announce that Phoenix Futures have been successful in principle in their bid to the Recovery Fund to establish a new National Specialist Family Service. The service, which will be located in North Ayrshire, will be based on an existing facility run by the organisation in Sheffield and will offer a family-focused programme of interventions for up to 20 families at one time. I've also worked with Police Scotland, Public Health Scotland and National Records of Scotland to reach agreement on providing more regular reporting on suspected drug deaths in our pursuit of getting more people into treatment quickly. Starting in September and for the first time in Scotland, quarterly reports on suspected drug deaths will be published, and this will allow us all to respond to what is needed more quickly and will of course help Parliament to monitor progress. Better information will allow us to set a treatment target for 2022. This year is about making sure same-day treatment is available and that the range of treatment options available is wider, as part of implementing the medication-assisted treatment standards. We have seen many actions being taken for the first time during 2020, and this includes the pilot project, where police officers have been carrying and administering naloxone. This will already have saved lives and builds on the way in which emergency services can contribute to our mission, with the ambulance service having led the way on naloxone carriage thus far. And I am keen to see more or all police officers carrying naloxone kits as quickly as possible. I have previously referred to media campaigns the Scottish Government will be running, and today I can announce that these campaigns will focus on the use of naloxone and on tackling stigma, still a barrier to accessing life-saving services. The creation of a National Care Service will be the biggest reform in health and care since the creation of a National Health Service in 1948. Ministers have agreed to consult on the remit of the National Care Service and whether to include alcohol and drug services in the systematic changes to the way in which people access services. In particular, we are asking whether residential rehabilitation should be commissioned on a national basis. Consultation, which opens next week, is an opportunity to consider how we can better support Scotland's most vulnerable and marginalised people, and we are committed to listening to the feedback, including those in the alcohol and drug sector. No one should underestimate the scale of the challenge we face. I certainly don't. We have made progress with other preventable deaths from alcohol, violence, some cancers, and so change is possible. But change will not always be comfortable, and I make no apologies for that. But through these changes and the actions I'm setting out today, we can improve and save lives as part of the national mission by getting more people into the protection of treatment and recovery. And this will help reduce drug deaths in Scotland. Presiding Officer, we have had the humility to accept what has been wrong, and going forward, we will have the courage to do what is right. Thank you.
Sir will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement, and I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions. And it'd be helpful if members who wish to ask a question put R in the chat function now. And I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It was vital that Parliament heard this statement today as thousands of Scots continue to die from drug abuse. But this crisis requires decisive action from the top. It demands leadership. So where is the First Minister? She wasn't at the memorial in Glasgow on Friday, and she has point blank refused to stand up and speak for her government today. It's not enough for the First Minister to admit she took her eye off the ball. Words are not going to solve this crisis. People need action, and they expect to hear from the First Minister. For the seventh year in a row, drug deaths have peaked. Our drug death rate is close to four times higher than any other country in Europe. In Scotland, if you live in a poorer area, you are 18 times more likely to die from drugs. Behind all those shocking statistics are lost loved ones and broken families. When is the First Minister in this government going to wake up? When will she stop abandoning our communities? When is she going to listen to those on the front line? Like the Minister, I attended the memorial in Glasgow on Friday, but while she wanted to quote song lyrics, I explained what Scottish Conservatives will do. We published our proposal for a Right to Recovery Bill, and it's with Parliament's team being prepared for its launch. It's been developed by frontline experts to guarantee everyone gets the treatment they need. It's backed by seven recovery organisations and apparently SNP MSPs. It would cut through the broken system and save lives. People who have lost family members and close friends to drugs deserve a straight answer. So if the First Minister won't come to Parliament today to give a commitment, will the Minister? Quite simply, will the Scottish Government be bold, back our bill?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Mr. Ross. I was appointed by the First Minister, an appointment approved by this Parliament, to lead the new national mission to tackle our drug deaths crisis. I report directly to the First Minister, and of course I'm accountable to Parliament for the work I have done day and day out since I was appointed 7 months ago, and it is only right that I make this statement in Parliament today. And I'm very glad of the opportunity to do so. I have written to the Presiding Officer before recess and last week to make sure that I conveyed my willingness and availability to respond to any parliamentary request from me. And I was also very glad to have the opportunity to attend the vigil on Friday to pay my tributes and to offer my condolences to those who had lost a loved one in person. Now, I know that Mr. Ross has not been in this Parliament as long as I have been, and I appreciate that he may not know me very well, but I don't play games and I'm not remotely interested in playground politics. With respect to his proposal to enshrine the right to treatment, let me be clear once again. I will, of course, as will the First Minister, give serious consideration to any proposition, serious and fair consideration. And I have never ruled out the need for further legislation, as I hope was demonstrated in my statement today with my comments around the National Care Service and justice system. But with respect, I have to say to Mr. Ross, I have still to see the bill. So I'm not going to give him a blind or blanket commitment. It is my job to look at the detail, because scrutiny works both ways. And bearing in mind, I have made a number of detailed commitments around investment and delivery to this Parliament, and of course, of the government's manifesto to implement. Mr. Ross wants me to implement his ideas and his manifesto commitments. It's imperative that I see the detail of that work. And I know that some stakeholders are very supportive of the proposal. Some of these stakeholders I've worked very closely with, for example, around how we address the anomalies caused by housing benefit, where if it wasn't for the action taken by this government, people would still have to be making harsh choices between accessing residential rehab and keeping their tenancy. But I'm determined that we will implement as much action as possible, and we will always give a fair and serious consideration to detailed and serious work when it comes forward.
I call Anna Sarwar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is no reflection of this Minister, but I'm extremely disappointed that this statement has not been delivered by the First Minister today. Nicola Sturgeon could not escape the fact that she and her party have been in government for almost 15 years, that she cut the budgets for drug and alcohol services, and that under her watch, our drugs deaths in Scotland are almost five times that of the rest of the UK, despite having the same laws. The Minister is right to say that this is Scotland's national shame, but she must recognise that it's the Scottish National Party's shame too. We need urgent action to save lives. We can't ignore the link between Scotland's higher drugs death rate and our suicide rates. We need a coherent strategy and a plan from this government. More funding is, of course, welcome, but it must do more than fill the holes in funding that their cuts already created. And while, yes, we do need to look at the drugs laws, that can't be a cover for this government's failure. This must be declared as a public health emergency. For some age groups, they were more likely to die from drugs over the last year than COVID at the height of this pandemic. We need a major effort off that scale to confront this crisis. So will the Minister commit to regular updates on the actual progress being made to reform services and guarantee the availability of residential rehab, integrate substance use and mental health services, increase levels of same-day prescribing, and back that all up with the funding it needs? If this really is a national mission, let's have that demonstrated by the government's actions.
Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I say to Mr. Sarwar that since my appointment, this is the fourth time I have appeared in front of Parliament, and at the last event where we had a very good cross-party debate, I indeed gave that commitment to make regular updates to Parliament on the detail of how we connect our emergency saving work with the longer term work to improve lives. So all of the work that he mentioned around how we increase capacity and access to residential care, how we support our workforce, how we implement our obligations in terms of human rights, how we turn our fine words into actions, how we will see the impact on the ground from the considerable increase in funding that we have seen this year. All of that and more, I have already given a commitment to give proactive updates to Parliament. And I would like to reassure Mr. Sarwar that we do indeed, you know, have a plan. In terms of his remarks, in terms of funding, yes, it's factually correct to say that in the financial year 2016-17, there was indeed a financial reduction. I would point to the fact that that was compensated for in future years. But there's a bigger issue here that since 2008, we have invested over £1 billion in drug and alcohol services. And it is clear that inputs don't always equal outputs. So as well as additional targeted long-term investment, it is also crucial that we follow the evidence, that this is about what we do, this is about leadership, and it's also about culture and how we get that culture of compassion and change in our services and in our society. And I'm sure, you know, Mr. Sarwar will have welcomed the announcements that I have made this year about widening treatment, £3 million for outreach services, our determination to implement the new medication assisted treatment standards. For the first time, we have published new standards, clear expectations, but with an implementation plan and resource to back that up. And I hope that he has seen significant announcements today, particularly in terms of meeting the needs of families and children, and that the work that we will do for the rest of the year is moving from annual reporting to quarterly reporting. We'll announce the new treatment target. We'll be focused on our work in terms of the National Collaborative and our work in and around the National Care Service, but also those important campaigns around tackling stigma and naloxone. And finally, Presiding Officer, the last point I make is a former criminal justice and mental health social worker, the point that Mr. Sarwar makes about the far better integration of addiction services and mental health services, I can assure him is not lost in me.
I call Julian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to extend my condolences to everyone who has tragically lost a loved one to drug overdose. As others have said, we need to see action now to prevent further loss of life. In June, a majority of MSPs supported my amendment to the government's motion on drug-related deaths. This called for the Scottish Government to investigate, as a matter of urgency, what options it had within the current legal framework to establish safe consumption rooms. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update on what progress has been made on establishing safe consumption rooms as part of wider harm reduction strategy and treatment options?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thanks to Ms Mackay. Ms Mackay will be aware that this government is firmly in support of the implementation of safe consumption rooms. Based on 30 years of evidence, there are 100 drug consumption rooms in 66 cities in 10 countries around the world. We know that they're not the only solution, but they do help to save lives, and we are committed to implementing those, irrespective of the constitutional opportunities or the constitutional constraints that we face. And I want to assure Ms Mackay that there is very detailed work going on within government right now. I am cautiously encouraged by that work, and while I don't as yet have a solution or proposition to put in front of Parliament today, I want to assure Parliament that when it comes to implementing evidence-based interventions that will save lives, I will leave absolutely no stone unturned.
I call Alex Cole-Hamilton to be followed by Emma Harper.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. We learned last week that nearly 1,400 people in a single year had their lives cut short, their potential extinguished, many of whom just were decades before their time. Apologies are hard to accept because pleas were dismissed for years, and I will never understand ministers surrendered both services and expertise by cutting ADP budgets so much in 2015 and 16. The drug deaths crisis will be ended through compassion and treatment, but people gripped by drugs misuse are still regularly directed into the criminal justice system. 200 people a year are being imprisoned for possession. That's not changed in a decade. And the police rightly say that it's both pointless and it damages lives. In March, at the second time of our asking, the Scottish Government finally agreed to the principle of diversion and stopping imprisoning vulnerable people. Now decriminalisation is under consideration by the task force. How will ministers take this forward?
Minister.
Thank you, I've always been clear, and I hope Mr. Cole-Hamilton will recognise this, that this is a public health emergency and that we can't arrest our way out of a drugs death crisis, and that we need to be reducing demand for drugs as well as the supply. And he is absolutely correct. We need to be preventing people going in to the criminal justice system in the first place. It is important to recognise that diversion has existed in Scotland for over 40 years. The work done by Criminal Justice Scotland or Community Justice Scotland has been very important and helping to roll out more consistent practice with this regard. But it's also important that every twist and turn of our justice system, that we are increasing opportunities for people to get into treatment, because it's treatment that will provide a protective factor and help people to turn their lives around. In terms of decriminalisation, I hope he knows this government has an open mind. We will be led by the evidence. We have made commitments in and around citizens' assemblies. It's imperative that we take our communities with us in the direction of travel. But we do need to be challenging ourselves and each other to be bold. He is right to point to the fact that the Drugs Death Task Force is undertaking some work on drug law reform, and I can assure him they will make recommendations that will both apply to the Scottish Government and to the UK Government, because there is no doubt about it that some of the UK-wide legislation does put limits on our public health approach, and that is what we are determined to overcome. Thank you.
Emma Harper, to be followed by Annie Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I also would like to offer condolences to all those who have lost their lives, as well as the families involved as well. The Scottish Government has rightly identified tackling drug-related stigma as a priority in our national mission in reducing drug deaths and harm. Can the Minister therefore outline what education is intended or is being provided to healthcare professionals who don't work directly in drug and alcohol services, such as hospital and community staff, as well as the wider public, to tackle drug-related stigma?
Minister.
Thank you. There is a wide range of work going on. Ms Harper will have heard me speak about the importance of our national media campaigns that will be unrolled later this year. And that's important to raise awareness across society, including those who, you know, work in either the drugs field or indeed wider health and social care. In terms of a stigma charter, there is work that has been led by the lived experience community with regards to that. And the point she makes about workforce development, I believe, is crucially important for the wider public service workforce, as well as those that are currently engaged in drug and alcohol service work. And in terms of the work that is led by the Deputy First Minister and NHS Education, she'll be aware of the work around our trauma-informed nation, which is essentially about asking what has happened to you, as opposed to asking people what is wrong with them. So all of this is very important work to tackling stigma, because we know stigma is an absolute barrier to people accessing treatment, and we've got to remove it, and we've got to have a far better discussion about why language matters.
Annie Wells, to be followed by Willie Coffey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too was at the memorial in Glasgow last Friday, and I too could see the hurt, anger and frustration that was on display from those who have tragically lost loved ones, and I too would like to send my condolences to those affected. But as the Minister has noted, the widespread availability of fake or street Valium continues to have a devastating effect on victims of drugs, with benzodiazepines involved in a staggering 73% of all Scottish drug deaths in 2020. Now there is a worrying suggestion of a correlation between street Valium-related drug deaths and the introduction of minimum unit pricing on alcohol. Will the Minister commit to a review to discover if there is a clear link?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Ms Wells may not be aware of this, but there is a regular review of the impact of minimum unit pricing on alcohol, and that evidence thus far shows that there is no relationship between minimum unit pricing and an increase in the use in benzodiazepines. I have nonetheless, in my statement, have commissioned a rapid review of current use of benzodiazepines because, you know, we need to know what is driving that, or have better information about what is driving that. Is it because people can't access the treatment they need quickly enough, or is it because the treatment that they are in receipt of is not right for them? I also hope that in terms of our work going forward to tackle the street valium crisis, that Ms Wells will also support my calls to the UK Government to introduce pill press regulation. It is not right that people can access pill presses and produce vast quantities of street valium and sell it for pennies in our streets of Scotland. The production of street valium is not happening elsewhere, it is happening in Scotland. So her support in seeking regulation of pill presses would be very helpful. And also the importance of drug checking facilities. Again, I need a licence from the UK Government around this. And I am in discussions with them, and they've been fairly, you know, constructive to date, I have to say. But there is this myth that drug checking facilities encourages or increases drug use, and that is not the case elsewhere around the world. Things like drug checking facilities helps to save lives, and this is an example of where we must be bold and we must follow the evidence.
I call Willie Coffey to be followed by Michael Mara.
Thank you. The Minister's announcement that there will be a specialist residential family service in Ayrshire is really welcome. Can she explain if she sees this family approach being one that could be rolled out across Scotland to support families, and especially women? And will she give further consideration to supporting other recovery settings and facilities as best we can, so that people can have genuine hope that they can find a better future for themselves after recovery?
Minister.
Thank you. I am absolutely delighted to make the announcement today of the national project that Phoenix Futures Trust has been successful in bidding for additional resource from our recovery fund. This is a national project. I can say to Mr Coffey that we are expecting bids from other providers, both in terms of filling that gap for women and women with children, but also in terms of our work to take a more regional approach to improving capacity and access to residential rehab in every part of Scotland. I do want to highlight the £5 million recovery fund that is available for providers to access. There's also the £5 million service improvement fund that again is available for service providers. But an important part of this project that we have announced today is about keeping families together. And this is part of our promise, both to, you know, children who have been care experienced, but also in terms of tackling the rise in drug-related deaths that are experienced amongst women. And I am very proud to make this announcement today. This is an important step forward, this national service, in ensuring that we break down some of the intergenerational problems, you know, with poverty, to improve life chances, and also to help families and parents on that road to recovery.
Michael Mara to be followed by Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. After years of failure and so many lost lives, this government's rhetoric must at last be consistent with the decisions the Minister takes. Does the Minister agree with me that the work of 12 staff providing wraparound intensive support cannot be replicated by 4 staff taking on that work on top of their existing jobs? That is what is happening to the Housing First scheme in Dundee. has a proven record of helping those with addiction maintain stable lives and has been praised by the First Minister. Will she, the Minister, be led by the evidence and immediately refund the Housing First project?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, let me give Mr Mara an assurance that I am more than happy to look in detail at this issue. I would really appreciate if he would write to me in full with the details. I, like him, am a big supporter of the Housing First approach. I know my colleague Kevin Stewart, who is now the Mental Health Minister, in his time as the Housing Minister was pivotal in driving this forward. The Housing First approach is crucial in terms of meeting the needs of people with multiple and complex needs, people who have mental health problems, drug and alcohol issues, as well as experiencing homelessness. So I can assure him that if he writes to me in detail, I will look at it, and I will look at it with some urgency, and will seek to address matters vis-a-vis him, but also with colleagues locally and across government.
Gillian Martin, to be followed by Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've listened to the Minister as she's outlined the welcome uplift in rehabilitation treatment availability. David Liddell, the CEO of Drugs, Scottish Drugs Forum, said this yesterday. There is a huge support within the drug treatment services for policymakers' moves to ensure more people get into treatment, that this strategy will be undermined if the needs of people using high doses of benzodiazepines are not adequately addressed. The Minister's touched on this in her answer to Annie Wells, and I welcome the proposed review. I'd like to ask the Minister how the use of street benzos has led to the tragic outcomes of the people behind the figures released, and what's been done to tackle the availability and supply of these unprescribed substances in our communities and help those who may be harmed by them.
Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to Ms Martin. She is quite correct to point to the evidence that we need to have a far better treatment offer for those who are using benzodiazepines and street Valium in particular. Of course, people are using benzodiazepines in the context of polydrug misuse. That makes treatment, you know, somewhat more complex, and the weighing up of the risks needs to be done with care. But nonetheless, I'm committed to galvanising the clinical community in Scotland, because we have to find a way to make people safer. I think there's no ideal solution necessarily in terms of how we do treat benzodiazepine dependency, but we need to have a treatment offer, and actually one that's far more person-centred, where people can have a wide range of options, are empowered to make an informed choice, and crucially are able to access treatment quickly at a time of asking. In terms of the work to address supply, notwithstanding my earlier comments that we have to be focused on reducing the demand for illicit drugs as well as reducing the supply of drugs, obviously I engage with the Justice Secretary and Police Scotland, who are very focused on serious and organised crime in this country. I will refer back to my quest for pill press regulation, as I know that this is something that not just the Royal College of Psychiatrists would like to see, but also Police Scotland are very much in favour of pill press regulation too. And as part of my discussions with the UK in and around this, I know that the UK government is seeking advice from the National Crime Agency, and they're expecting, you know, further information this autumn.
Sue Webber, to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to thank the Minister for taking the time to make such an extensive statement today. And again, building on the answer that she's just provided, Ms Martin, the SNP have said that they will do everything they can to tackle Scotland's drugs death crisis. However, the UK Government has invited the Scottish Government to work with them on Project Adder three times, and three times the SNP have snubbed them. Their persistent refusal to work with the UK Government is costing lives. The First Minister admitted that she's let Scotland's drug death crisis spiral out of control, and the SNP's obsession with independence has come at a high cost. and the Scottish Government must focus on the devolved public health and justice systems they control. So when will you accept this invitation from the UK Government and start working constructively with them to solve this national crisis?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, can I assure Ms Weber that I work constructively with everyone? It's just unfortunate that it's not always reciprocated. The Scottish Government has indeed had a close look at Project ADDER, and the Drugs Desk Task Force participates in the Project ADDER learning network, so that we are keeping our ear to the ground in terms of any learning from that. But the harsh reality is that the Scottish Government wants to implement a public health approach to this drugs deaths crisis. And Project ADDER, I would suggest to Ms Weber, is not entirely replicable of a good public health approach. So, you know, it's not that we don't look at the evidence or what's happening elsewhere. It's just that Project ADDER doesn't fit our needs. We have a particularly acute problem in Scotland, and we need to fully implement a public health approach. I can't emphasise that enough, Presiding Officer. I would also point Ms Weber to the direction of other work that was commissioned by the UK Government in respect of the second report from Dame Carol Black, which has much more synergy with the work that we're doing in Scotland. It's about changing culture. It's about investing in treatment services. It's about promoting recovery. It's about making those links with housing and tackling poverty. And it's about that real culture and systems change, and also about having joined up government. So we do look and learn from wherever. I'm just sad that that isn't always reciprocated with some of the requests that I'm making to the UK Government, very reasonable requests that, you know, it's now high time that we had a review of the Misuse of Drugs Act, for example.
I call Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Minister, every drugs death is a complete tragedy, so it's critical the Scottish Government continue to invest to tackle this epidemic, ensuring quick access to treatment and community interventions. Can you provide me today with assurances that the Scottish Government are doing all that they can to improve the situation while working within the limitations of devolved powers?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let me assure Jackie Dunbar that as a pragmatist, my focus is always in doing as much as I can, as fast as I can, with the powers and resources that I have at my disposal, notwithstanding that I will continue to work with others and persuade others to do what I think they can do to help us too. The core aim of our national mission is to get more people into treatment, because, to be frank, we do not have enough of our people in treatment, and we need to, when people ask for help, respond to that request quickly. We should not miss those golden opportunities when people seek help and support. And some of the examples of where we are connecting our emergency and life-saving work with that broader work to get people into treatment and the work to help improve their life chances would be around our work around what's called non-fatal overdose care pathways. And that's work that recognises that for people who tragically die, they have often, more than half of them, have a history of overdose. And notwithstanding, you know, the need to prevent people having an overdose in the first place, but when people reach such a crisis point, it's imperative that we offer them help as quickly as possible. And there's a number of mechanisms and services which we are now funding to improve that. We are using peer navigators in hospitals, for example, people with lived experience to reach out. The Scottish Ambulance Service, who have been pivotal in developing non-fatal overdose pathways and the rollout of naloxone, are part of that emergency response, but are doing sterling work in connecting people to local services. And also our investment in outreach services, because we need to be far better at proactively identifying those people most at risk. And we need to provide services that provide wraparound care, that are less judgmental, that increases the chances of people remaining in treatment. And then when people fall out of treatment or relapse, we need to be following them up.
I call Sandesh Gulhani to be followed by Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So looking at the rollout of naloxone with police, if anyone injects a substance into someone else's body against their wishes, they are subject to being charged with assault. So how will the Scottish Government ensure police officers are not sued for administering naloxone?
Minister.
And I assure Mr. Gulhani that the Lord Advocate has given very robust assurances on that matter. The evidence from across the world will show that naloxone can save lives. And I know that Mr. Gulhani, as a serving clinician, will be very focused on evidence-based interventions and evidence-based treatments. And if we look at areas such as British Columbia and Canada, there was three things that they did. They introduced same-day prescribing, safe consumption rooms, and widened the distribution and rollout of naloxone. And there is a very important Four Nations consultation that has been launched today, and that's about widening the distribution of naloxone. Our Lord Advocate, our previous Lord Advocate, was able to, in response to the pandemic, make some exceptions so that we could widen the distribution of naloxone to non-drug services, you know, safely, medically and legally. And we need to continue with that work, and the consultation, I hope, it will lead to a permanent changes in the regulation and legislation across the UK, because I believe it's beholden on all public servants to do everything that we can to help with this emergency response. I'm a former social worker. I was never a clinician, but hand on heart, if I had had the opportunity when I worked in prisons or in the communities to carry naloxone, I would have been more than happy to do so.
Colette Stevenson to be followed by Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank the Minister for everything she has said today. Can the Minister outline what assessment has been made of the success of overdose prevention facilities elsewhere in the world? And can they help play a part in reducing deaths from drug use? Also, does the Minister agree with me that it's vital that family members are also able to access the support they need?
Minister.
Yes, as I said earlier to another member, there are 100 safe consumption rooms around the world. There is a massive evidence base that they work and they help to save lives, and that they also help people with their onward road, their onward journey into recovery. They're an opportunity to connect with people at where they are at a moment in time, but also provide opportunities and other information and support to address some of the other issues that are perhaps underlying their use of drugs in the first place. And as I hope Colette Stevenson will know, I am absolutely committed to the plight of families. We fund the Scottish families affected by drug and alcohol. There is a £3 million family and child fund for local organisations, grassroots organisations, the third sector, to apply for. We have also provided additional money and uplift to alcohol and drug partnerships, and been very clear that a proportion of that must be invested in whole family approaches and family inclusive practice.
And Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank the Minister for her statement today and some constructive measures that were announced, particularly around benzodiazepines, which, as we know, have been the key driver in the tragic increase in deaths. I'd like to ask the Minister what approaches she's considering, particularly around policing. There have been some particularly good innovations in different parts of the UK. I note Thames Valley and West Midlands in particular, led by the Police and Crime Commissioners, to approach a more enlightened methods of policing. And I think that's something that we should be forcing Police Scotland to look at more seriously, with political leadership from the Justice Secretary and others in government, where Police and Crime Commissioners are shown the way in England, including, as the Minister had mentioned, around drug testing, which we've seen progress in Bristol with the Loop project, which has been really, really successful on the ground. So would the Minister consider looking at those benchmarking opportunities and perhaps leading more active delegations, including MSPs, to those places of innovation where we can learn from them?
Minister.
Well, I think that there is now less travel restrictions. I think there will be more opportunities for myself, other ministers, and indeed in partnership with MSPs, to go and see for ourselves innovation that currently exists in Scotland or elsewhere in the UK. And I want to reassure Mr. Sweeney that I have engaged with police and crime commissioners. It strikes me that they are wrestling with many of the same issues and some of the same frustrations that I experience with the UK government, but they, like me, you know, want to work in partnership and constructively with all tiers of government to implement evidence-based solutions. I will certainly go and look at the Loop project. My understanding that in terms of drug checking facilities, that there was one licence a few years ago for a particular event in England. But there is a reticence within the UK government to issue those licences, although what they have said to me is that if I, you know, provide information and evidence for areas of particular need in Scotland, that they would look at that. So I will, you know, press the UK government at every twist and turn. But I think in the same way that police and crime commissioners, who have different powers and responsibilities from the situation in Scotland, but in the same way that they look at how they can use their powers and their resources and the opportunities they have at their disposal, likewise, we must, at every aspect of our criminal justice system, look at the opportunities that we have to make our criminal justice system more evidence-led and more humane.
Thank you. That concludes the statement by Angela Constance on actions being taken to reduce drug deaths in Scotland, and I close this meeting.